This morning about being surrounded by his presence, and I was in a quandary whether to entitle the message Surrounded with His Presence or There Be More with Us Than with Them. But I believe that God is looking upon his people today and wanting to empower us against the works of darkness, because on every side you can't watch the telly or watch any newscast, but there's conflict and everything is negative. There is no positivity. There's a lot of excellent, wonderful things going on in our world, because God has created this world for its beauty and for the purpose of his people. So the world is not bad. It's the people who live in the world that is bringing corruption to it. So I just thought about going through battles. And I just wondered, did you ever feel that you're in a battle alone? You know, maybe you're with somebody and you're having a disagreement, but you're still alone because there's a disagreement. And it's the work of the enemy to bring division in this hour. Division in the church, division in marriages, division with parents and children. That's the work of the enemy. And God is working in the lives of his people. And it's not uncommon, because all through the Old Testament, here we have the people of God, God's chosen people. He's did miraculous miracles before them. And yet it's difficult for them to be obedient. It's difficult for them to follow God's plan. And so they're always in difficulties and they're always in trouble. And God allowed all this to deal with them. And I believe that God is dealing with our country today. And I believe that he's dealing with Christianity. And they talk about the things of the world being so different today. And I say this to you in love, that church world is different today than it was in the days of my youth. And so I just want us to think about being surrounded by his presence. Sometimes we think we can get away with things, but we cannot get away with anything because we are surrounded by his presence. Now, we love that message when we need him. When we need him, we love to know he's there to help us. But we forget that he's there in our bad moments. We forget that he sees our negative things that go on in our life. And so I want us to come to a fresh revelation that he surrounds us, and he protects us when we don't even know he's there. You know, sometimes we just go about our business, never ever recognizing that he supported us in a situation or in a crisis, or he covered us, you know, in a near accident, or he was always there for us. So today, it's not any different than it was in the days of the Israelites, because God has given us a pattern to obey. It's right here. And as we obey, as we listen to his word, things are not as difficult. Does that mean we won't have difficulties? No. That means that he will surround us with his presence in the difficult seasons. And so as we look at the scripture today, it comes from 2 Kings, if you'd like to turn there. 2 Kings chapter 6. You may be familiar with this. If you've been in the church world, been born again very long, you know about this passage of scripture. But it was heavy on my heart. And Elisha had been obedient to God. And in chapter 6, we find out the Syrian king is trying to take away something from God's people. How many know that's where we are today? Mm-hmm. Because the enemy wants to take away your peace, your joy. He wants to take away everything from you spiritually, but he also wants to take away material things from you. You know, bills go up, less salary, all those kinds of things, financial difficulties. So he's warring on us, not only spiritually, but also physically. And so in this situation with Elisha, he was obedient to give counsel to the king, to the Israelites. And the king of Syria sought to encamp around about Israel, or the Judea, same as Israel, to encamp around about them and to bring destruction. And I don't want this to be negative this morning, but I do want to cause us to be mindful that the enemy seeks to encamp about us to destroy anything spiritual in our life. And I know this over the years, after serving God for many years, I can look back in my life and I can see times when he encamped around about me, and it was only the mercy and the grace of the Lord that brought me through that. And I got real high in God and I did really well. And then I had another siege where he encamped around about me. So this is his job. But our job as a soldier of the kingdom of God is to go through those encampments and to have a spiritual vision to see this is the works of darkness and God is greater than this, and no matter what happens, I'm going to trust God and I'm going to be strong and powerful in the midst of this situation. So Israel was encamped around about, and every time the king of Syria came to take control of them and get their land, Elisha would prophesy and tell them, that's not a safe place, don't go there. And so they obeyed the prophet of God. They had it in their heart and ear to hear what the Spirit of God was saying through the prophet. So verse 11, the king is totally upset now because they've tried to encamp around about them two or three times, and every time the prophet tells them not to go there, and they listen to the word of God and they don't go there. And so now the king is troubled. And it says, therefore the heart of the king of Syria was sore troubled for this thing. This is what I hope we will do to the devil today. Yeah. You know, he was sore troubled, and he called his servants together and he said unto them, will you not show me which one of you is for the king of Israel? Because he thought somebody was telling them the secrets of his bedchamber. And verse 12 says, one of the servants said, there's none, Lord, O king, but Elisha the prophet that is in Israel. He telleth the king of Israel the words that thou speakest in the bedchamber. I love to have God be on our side, and the power of the Holy Spirit to be on our side, and to alert us to the works of darkness when they come against us. So the king wants to capture Elisha. Now, I can't for the life of me understand if he knew that the prophet knew when he was coming and they kept hiding from him. Why did he think he could find the prophet? I don't know. But the devil's stupid, you know. And so he's out to capture Elisha. He's out to take the land from Israel. And so the enemy of our soul is always seeking to capture our spirit, to capture our joy. I tell you, man, of a truth, the Church of Jesus Christ needs to have the joy of Jesus in them. Yeah. Like in the old days when we got saved, we shouted and we cried and we ran the aisles and we were full of joy because we had been relieved from the bondages of sin. But after 50 years, we're just complacent and we say, this is Sunday, I go to church. But you know what? Well, our hearts have to be running over with the Spirit, with the oil of joy, and with the peace that passes all understanding. I don't know why I'm peaceful today, because I'm in crisis. But the joy of the Lord sustains me. So I lay the crisis here, and I joy in the power and the presence of the Lord. So the king is mad. The king says, who is telling Israel the secrets? And they said, it's Elisha. So the king says, go and spy out the land. You know, you can follow this in this passage of scripture. Spy out the land, see where Elisha is, so that we can surround him. So they find him, and look at this. They surround him in the night. They surround him in the night. How many of you have ever suffered a restless night? They surround him in the night. You're supposed to have peace and rest, and you're supposed to just snore and be relaxed. Unless your mate beside you puts a pillow over your face. know, it's supposed to be a peaceful moment. You're supposed to be away from the strife of the day and have rest. Rest means rest.
Yes.
And yet we can go and be there all night and not have rest.
Yeah.
And the enemy surrounds us in that quiet time. Sometimes he's bothered by all the busyness that we do. And sometimes he's bothered because we have devotions and because we pray and because we do spiritual things. And so he waits till we're in that quiet time when all the voices are silent. He surrounds us in the night to harass us. And so, you know, we see that in the night, the enemy gathered around. And in the morning, the servant of the Lord got up and he went out, and he, to his astonishment, he saw all of the enemy that had surrounded Elisha. Now, God was with Elisha, and Elisha had his problems too, church. He was not a perfect man, but he had his problems too. But he was obedient in the midst of his problems and difficulties. And so God would speak to Elisha, and God would guide him and lead him. So Elisha was at rest. His servant got up. He saw the multitude of the enemy. And he speaks to his master, and he says, when the servant of the man of God was risen up early, verse 15, he went out, and behold, a host. I don't know how much a host is, but that's a lot of people. They were compassed about the city. There was horses and chariots, and the servant's heart failed him. The servant said unto his master, alas, what shall we do? Can't you just feel the anxiety and the fear and the stress when he saw the multitude of the enemy encamped around about him, and all there was thee and me, just Elisha and the servant? And you probably know the outcome, because in verse 16, Elisha answers and he says, fear not. Now, church, when you're encamped about with the enemy and somebody says, fear not, you say, yeah, that sounds good, but we have to take that as law. Law from the Word of God. We cannot fear, because the enemy weakens our spiritual condition by fear. So Elisha says, fear not, for they that be with us are more than they that be with them.
Amen.
And I probably think at that moment that servant looked at him and said, who's with us? That would be what we would do if somebody said that to us. You know, but what Elisha was saying is that there is a host of the angelic host of God that surround us, and that we have to have spiritual eyes to see that God is going to bring us through the crisis. I think everyone here at some time in your life has suffered a crisis, but today we're still here. We're in our right mind, we're still worshiping, and we're probably better for the crisis, because if we obey God, we're still on track with God. And so when Elisha said, fear not, for they that be with us are more than be against us. Well, actually, if we have Father God, power of the Holy Spirit, and his Son Jesus, there's more with us than is with the works of darkness. So Elisha prayed, and the servant's eyes were opened, and he saw a greater multitude than the enemy, and they had chariots of fire. Fire of God is important to the church world today, but they don't preach much about the fire of God. I follow our evangelists throughout the land who have magnitudes of congregations, and I follow what they preach, and I follow what God is doing. Some are good, and some are you know, watered down, but nonetheless, there's not a lot being spoken, you know, in some places about the fire of God. What is the fire of God? It's a purifying essence that comes from the throne of God. When the Spirit of God spoke this morning, he said, purify your hearts, purify your hands. There is a purity that God is requiring of the Church of Jesus Christ today. We are not to be at ease in Zion. We are warriors. We are in a warfare. We're struggling for the power of God to be released and revealed in the hearts of men and women today.
Yes.
And we are in a warfare against the corruption of our world and the corruption that is going on in our society. And it's affecting God's people. And unless we recognize that we are warriors and we are servants and we need to pray harder, we need to read the word more, we need to be more involved, we need to think about our Christian life more than we do about the things of this world. So Elisha prayed. And when he prayed, you know, he had to have faith because, you know, he was just there with his servant and there was this multitude of enemies surrounding him. But when he prayed, the forces of heaven came and camped around about them. And he knew that if he feared, they would leave. But if he did not fear, the power of God would overcome the enemy. And he prayed that the servant's eyes would be opened. I pray that the church of Jesus Christ will have their eyes opened to this moment in history when we need to combat the forces of darkness that are coming against our world and against the church and against the beloved of God. We are in warfare. And there is so much spiritual insight in this account. God is always in control. It looked like the enemy was in control, but God is always in control. And we may suffer heartache, and we may suffer disappointment, and we may suffer crisis, but God is still in control. He is the controlling force in the believer's life. And according to our faithfulness, and according to our obedience, and according to our willingness to say, God, take me through. You know, I like to go around, but we need to ask the Lord, just take me through. Strengthen me to get through this. Do in me what you want to do. Amen. Get glory out of this and bring me forth triumphant. According to the faithfulness. Now, have you noticed that when the enemy comes and he comes in the night seasons, you know, he comes to bring restlessness. He comes to bring anxiety. This is not negative, church. These are the things that are going on in the works of darkness. So just be alerted to it. And he comes with extreme tiredness. How many go to bed and you're still too tired to even go to sleep?
Yeah.
You know, because he forces his negativeness upon us. The enemy of our soul seeks out our weak moments. And I'm sorry to say that we do have those weak moments because we're in the flesh and we have those tired moments, you know. And sometimes we have stress, just sometimes, you know. But we have these times and it takes prayer. And after prayer, it takes spiritual eyes to realize that the enemy is at work. To realize that what is going on in your life that could be negative or could be hurtful or could be a disappointment, that the enemy is behind that. And when we have to have spiritual eyes, you have to have ears to hear what the Spirit of the Lord is saying. And this is more important today than it's ever been in the church world. You know, we would like to, sometimes in our crisis, we just want to blame something else. We want to blame a circumstance or we want to blame somebody. But it's a principality, church, and we know that. This church can probably quote that scripture. We wrestle not against the principalities and powers, but, you know, about wickedness in high places. Now, church, listen to this. It says, but against principalities and powers, against rulers of darkness of this world and spiritual wickedness in high places. Is that where our world is today?
Yes.
That's where we are today. We have principalities. We have powers in government. You know, we have rulers of darkness that are trying to rule our country. We have spiritual wickedness. That's not any one individual. It's that these are spirits that are operating in government. And while they're operating, there's also godly spirits in government. There's Christians in government. We need to pray for the religious people that are in government. Some of them are just religious, but some of them are born again, and some of them know what right from wrong, and some of them trust God. You know, and so there's a warring going on even in our country. Even as Paul said, there's a warring in our members because our spirit wants to be holy, but there's that element of our flesh that just wants to, you know, be negative on occasion. So I believe that God is speaking to us in a powerful way. And I want you to realize Colossians 2:14, you know, Jesus' death on the cross took away the ordinances and the restrictions that the Israelites could not obey. You know, they had restrictions. I mean, for goodness sakes, today we just go to McDonald's, but in those days, they cooked the whole meal. They had to separate their pots from whatever they cooked milk in. I don't know all that. All the restrictions and the laws. And they had to wear certain garments, and they had to do all sorts of physical things to have the presence of God in their life. But today, this passage of scripture in Colossians 2:14, it says there that Jesus blotted them out. I mean, I don't think to really understand this, you've got to read the book of Leviticus, when it tells you all the food laws and all the clothing laws and all of those kinds of things that we would be under if Christ hadn't nailed them to the cross.
Yes, right.
And this scripture says that he blotted out those restrictions and those rules and all those ordinances, and he took them away by nailing them to the cross. And he spoiled principalities and powers, and he made a show of them openly, and he triumphed over them. We are a triumphant church.
Yes.
We are a triumphant believer. We have got to begin to practice being triumphant.
Yes.
I don't know about you, but I whine a little.
No.
We have to come to a place to be triumphant.
Yes.
And those who are around me very close, my family says amen, you know. But we are triumphant. I mean, there's a more to Christianity. We come, we get saved, and then there's a life to live. And there's a power, and there's an anointing, and there's a Holy Ghost that we can depend upon. And there's more with us than is against us, because the heavenly host stands for us.
Yeah.
And this is so wonderful. When we triumph in Christ, his presence surrounds us. Because when we triumph, we worship. And when we worship, God inhabits the praises of his people. And it's very hard to say, oh Lord, I praise you with this financial deficit. It's hard to say that, right? I mean, the first thing that happens is a negative thing comes, you know. And that, like at the dairy now, at Anderson Erickson, my family's all up in arms because they might, what do you call it?
Strike.
Yeah, they might strike. And I said, well, just trust the Lord. You know, and I'm sure they got. You know, because they don't have the essence and the triumphant strength of God in their life. And so there's all kinds of things that's coming down the tube to distract us from the power and the anointing that God has available to us in this hour. Look at this Psalm 140. It says, I know that the Lord will maintain the cause of the afflicted. You know, it's so important, at least out of this church, this ministry that Brother Doug has and our food bank ministry and all of that, we're trying to do what part we can to help the afflicted. And yes, you know, they can come inside, but for some reason in their DNA, they don't want to come inside. And so they have their difficulties and their problems and they're afflicted. And the word of God says, I know the Lord will maintain the cause of the afflicted. And listen to verse 13. It says, surely the righteous shall give thanks unto his name, and the upright shall dwell in his presence. So church, if we have Jesus Christ in us, we are dwelling in his presence. He knows the good, he knows the bad, he knows the faithfulness, he knows the disobedience. He knows the fear. He knows the anxiety. He also knows the trust, the hope, and the love that we have. And Psalm 31:20, I love this. I read the Bible through many times, never saw this. I'm thankful the Holy Spirit pointed it out. It says, thou shalt hide us in the secret of thy presence. So the enemy comes to fight us. And he does not understand that we are hid in the presence of God. Now, who doesn't understand is us. We don't know that we forget that we're hid in the presence of God.
Yeah.
And we need to combat the works of darkness. We need to combat our fears, our anxieties, our anxiousness. Combat it with the word of the living God. To do that, we have to have the word in us. And to do that, we have to be infiltrated with the word of God. And we have to be filled with communication skills to touch the throne of God. And just saying, God help me, is not going to get it, church. There has to be a supplication. And I don't know the intenseness of that word, but that means we got to get down to business when we talk to God. And we have to come to him with a right heart. And we have to come to him beseeching him and come to him in worship. And he will hide us in the secret of his presence, you know, from the pride of man, from the pride of this world. You know, he's going to hide the church in tribulation. He's going to take care of his people. He did not create us to be persecuted. He created us to be the righteousness of God in Christ. And if we are persecuted, he created us to have the strength to go through it so that we can be triumphant in God. I need this message. I need to be triumphant. We need to be triumphant.
Amen.
We need to think more of being triumphant than being at loss. So he says he'll hide us and he'll keep us as secretly in a pavilion. I'm going to use that as a weapon. The next time the enemy harasses me, I'm going to say, oh God, bring me into that secret place, into that pavilion. Hide me from the works of darkness. Hide me from negativeness. Hide me from fear. Hide me from that. Cover me with your presence. Blessed be the Lord, for he has showed us his marvelous kindness. In 2 Chronicles 32, another enemy called the Assyrians, not the same army, another army, they came against Judah, they camped around about them. It worked of the enemy to surround us, but we are surrounded by the presence of God. We have to believe that, we have to trust that, we have to walk in that. And so the enemy came and surrounded Judah. Did you ever have just one problem? Usually if you have one problem, you have two or three, right?
Yeah.
Like Job, you know, Job didn't have just one problem, he had a multiplex of problems.
Yeah.
And I don't think I've ever had just one problem at a time. There's usually two or three. And that's him surrounding us, see? He's surrounding us so we can't think straight. And so that we are filled with anxiety and stress. So the enemy encamped around about Judah again. But thank God his presence is always there. You know, we are surrounded by the Holy Spirit of God, but not only surrounded, but what does the scripture say? He dwells in us.
Yes.
So in this passage of scripture, 2 Chronicles 32, it records a gigantic crowd that encamps around Israel again, and that this huge crowd was around their water fountains. And so they were really, you know, going to stay there until they got a hold of the property of the Jews. And so they had the water, they had all that they needed. And all of a sudden, the people of God began to say, why should we let them have this water? You know, maybe we can cause them to, you know, not to be thirsty and to take away the water. So they began to build up and shut up the water. And so Hezekiah, there's some spiritual things I want to point out briefly here this morning from verse 5. Hezekiah was the king, and here's how he responded to the enemy encamping around about him. First of all, he did what he could, and what he could was dry up the water. So he dried up the water. But here's what the scripture says, verse 5. Hezekiah strengthened himself. He built up a wall that was broken. He raised it up to towers and another wall without. And he repaired the city, and then he made darts and shields in abundance. I say to the church today, we're in a warfare against the powers of darkness, against the powers of corruption and lust, And I want to say to the church, we cannot be dismayed. God has surrounded us with his presence. Now, first we must strengthen ourselves in the word of God.
Yeah.
When the problem hits, before we cry and before we complain, strengthen ourselves in the word of God. That's easy to say, but if we don't do it, we will not be strong enough for the task ahead.
Yeah.
So we must strengthen ourselves. We must build up a wall against fear and anxiety and stress and unbelief. Build it up, and we just got to do that physically. God, I build up a wall against this fear that's trying to get at me. I build up a wall against this anxiety and this stress. I build it up, put it up. Let your presence be a wall about me. And third, we need to raise it up high. Raise up the Spirit of God in it. Raise it up. He said, I will build up towers. What can that mean? Well, Habakkuk said, I will get me up on the tower, and I will see what God can do. If you would raise yourself up out of the problem and have a spiritual eye to see what it is God wants to do in your life, or what you need God to do in your life. Because sometimes God is dealing with us to grow spiritually. He's dealing with us to build our faith. He's dealing with us to do the right thing and to honor him. And they repaired things. You know, church, we need to prepare, for the kingdom of God is at hand. And he said they made darts and shields in abundance. Now, some would say, were they fearful? Because I was talking to Brother Bill Fromer about security in our house. And I said, you know, I'd like you to get together some of the men when you get home and talk to them and, you know, just have a plan. Because, you know, the enemy attacks. So let's have a plan. That's wisdom. And somebody said to me, are you in fear? I go like, no, I'm not in fear. It's the wisdom of God that we might have a plan. I mean, you know why so many people were shot in the casino place? Because they ran. And the enemy had fun at the targets. You know, the thing of it is get down. Get down, get out of the way, don't run. And we talk about that, and it's not fear. But, you know, the enemy is out to attack God's people.
Yes. Yes,
and he's attacking us, and we have to have the power of the word of God. We have to have wisdom. He says, get wisdom, and all your wisdom, get understanding. These are the things that God speaks to us. And so Hezekiah prepared. You know, he strengthened himself, you know, and he built up the wall that was broken down so the enemy couldn't get in. And he raised up the tower so they could see the enemy. And he did everything that he could do to combat the works of darkness. And church, we cannot just sit here and say, God, take care of me. We have to do what we can do. Build up ourselves in the most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. You know, people got the Spirit 20 years ago and they got four words and that's it. That's not enough. We've got to build up ourselves in the most holy faith, praying in the Spirit. That's what the Word of God says. So, saints, it's time to rise up, repair the breaches. If there's broken places in your life, I talk to Christians every day, and they tell me about something that happened in their past that they're still mad at, and they're still holding a grudge over, and they won't forgive somebody. That's a breach in your Christian experience. I know I'm not talking to anybody like that here, but if you know somebody like that, you need to share this word with them, because that's a breach. And God doesn't move in those kinds of things. He wants us to come before him and come into his presence with holiness and righteousness. What is righteousness? That's being in right standing. If we're holding a grudge, we can't be in right standing. That's the word of the Lord today. So Habakkuk said, I will stand upon my watch, I will set me upon the tower, and I will see what God will say to me. If we waller in our problems, we will not see what God wants to say to us. But if we rise above our problem, you know, they that run shall not be weary, they that walk shall not faint, and then we will mount up as wings as eagles. So in our spirit man, we rise up so that we can see the difficulty and the problem and see what God will say. And maybe he'll just say, I'm going to see if you can make it through this fire. I'm going to see if you can make it through this mountain. You know, and we begin to see that God is working a way of glory in us for his good. Like in Sunday school class this morning, you know, Martha did not have the understanding, but God was going to be glorified in what Jesus did. And the same thing today, Jesus wants to do things in us that will glorify the kingdom of God. So I say to the church this morning, there be more with us than there are with the enemy, because the host of heaven is with us. Somewhere in Romans it talks about there's a host of heaven. You know, that there's the king with us and around us. And then also the presence of God is with us. And we need to be more mindful of that, because it will affect our Christian experience. It will affect our Christian walk. Sometimes we think, we minister on the assembly line and talk to them and that, and then we wonder why they don't show respect or they don't honor, because then they see our life, and our life doesn't exemplify Christ. And that doesn't mean we have to pin our hair up and wear long sleeves and have a solemn look on our face like we're holy. That's not what it's about. It's about emulating Christ in our life, in our actions. And I believe that God is speaking to us in this hour to be more mindful that we're a soldier of the kingdom, and we need to don the instruments of a soldier, and we need to have the breastplate, and we need to have our feet shod with the gospel. What does that mean? That means every day you walk through the scripture, not just one or two scriptures, but you walk through a passage of scripture that is meaningful and that gives you insight. So in closing this morning, Jude, the 20th verse, here's how you do this, church. Building up yourselves on the most holy faith, keep yourselves in the love of God, looking for the mercy of the Lord Jesus Christ unto eternal life. And as some, have compassion, making a difference. I think the Lord is saying, some people you can't change, just have compassion. Have compassion for them and move in love towards them. You know, we just can't make headroads because they have their own way, but just have compassion and pray for them and love them until they can come through. Well, this army gathered together, and the king, spake comfortably to them. Now, I learned a lesson there, because I'm probably the kind that wants to go, okay, you didn't do this right. Why didn't you do that? Do this. But he spoke comfortably to them. I learned a lesson there. He spoke gently to them, loving to them, and he promoted, you know, the Spirit of God in him, because he believed in God. And it says he spoke comfortably to them, and here's what he said. Be strong and courageous. This is from the word of Joshua said this also. He said, be strong and be courageous. Don't be afraid. Don't be dismayed. You know, for the king of Assyria, nor for the multitude that's with him, for there be more with us than he. Second warfare, second time God said that. And what is so important, church, if you just give me 1 minute, is to understand what dismayed means. Because I think more often we would say, oh, I'm not discouraged, you know, but we would be dismayed. And dismayed means that we are perplexed and we're uncertain how to deal with the crisis or the circumstances of our life. And I think every one of us go through those things. When the bills go up or something like that, then we have an uncertainty. How will I deal with this? That's dismay. It's just a simple term that we don't look at. It's very strong. But if you look it up in the dictionary, it just goes on and on and on what it means. It means fearful,
It means uncertain. It means a person who has no courage. And we have to have courage in this day because we are fighting a warfare against the powers of darkness and the rulers in high places, not only in our government, but in the spiritual realm and in the church world. The church world at large has rulers of darkness. And we have to pray against the forces of the enemy. So I want to say this morning, you're not alone in your struggles. I probably preach it to myself. But if you have any struggles, you're not alone in those struggles. Because there's more with us than there is with the enemy. And we need to remember that. We're not alone. And the Bible says in Psalm 16, He will show us the path of life.
Yes.
In His presence is fullness of joy. That's kind of a little thermometer there. If we have joy, we know, well, okay, that person is walking in His presence. Because we have fullness of joy. But you know, the enemy has robbed the joy of the saints. Because the joy of the saints is unlike anybody else's joy. You know, they can go to the tavern on Saturday night and they're happy and they're joyful, you know, but in the morning it's a headache. But the saints of God have a joy that's everlasting. So I want to say this to you today. You know, that was Hebrews 12:1, which says, we are compassed about with a great cloud of witnesses. So we're surrounded. And there's more of us than of them. 1 Peter 5:7-10, casting all your cares upon Jesus for the care of you. Now you must be sober. You must be vigilant. Because your adversary, the devil, is as a roaring lion, walking about seeking whom he may devour. Now, would you look at that and say, well, that's a negative scripture? Because today I'm talking about our negatives so that we can see how we can be positive in God. So here the scripture says that there is a devil that's walking about, and he's seeking to devour you. He's seeking to take away your peace and your joy. And he does it in the simplest way. You know, he isn't out necessarily robbing and killing in your presence, but he's just doing little things that rob you of your joy and your presence of God. But I tell you something, whatever your care is today, if you cast it upon Jesus, you're going to give the devil a black eye. You're going to make him troubled like the king of the past that got troubled when he heard that God was for the Israelites. So we must put on the whole armor of God to protect ourselves. Here's my final scripture. Romans 8:38. I'm persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor the devil, nor powers, nor things present, or things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus.
Amen.
Because there be more with us than with them. And we are surrounded by the presence of God, and His presence lives in us. So let us come before His presence with thanksgiving. Let us make a joyful noise unto Him with psalms. The Lord is a great God and a King above all. Believe it?
Amen.
Amen. Okay, I want to see the saints just dancing out the door this morning. We are triumphant in our Lord and Savior. Amen. Amen. Jesus, we love you this morning. God, help us. Help us to triumph over the cares of this life. Help us not to be worn out by this, God. We give us strength to stand as a soldier of the kingdom of God. Give us strength in our warfare, O God. Give us a hunger for your word and a hunger to communicate with you in prayer and supplication and fastings, O God. Lord, we love you, we worship you, we honor you.